You're watching the free version of SynthEyes Essentials. For projects and footage, head to BorisFX.com for the premium download. Hey, and welcome back to SynthEyes Essentials. First of all, congratulations for doing your first proper solve in the last class. Good job. While refining that solve, we already spent a little time in the trackers room. Well, this is where we will spend most of our time today, because this class is all about manual tracking, or, as SynthEyes likes to call it, supervised tracking. We will be working on this shot today, with me walking the camera down the stairs. Before we start our supervised tracking, let's answer the most obvious question first. Why do we want to do a supervised track? To be honest, this shot could as well be solved using the methods you already know. But it also has some unique features that explain the functionality of the supervised trackers really well. And supervised tracking is an essential skill for mastering SynthEyes. With it, you will be able to master much more challenging shots than this one. Also, we will be able to see how many trackers we actually need to get a proper solve. As this was once again shot on my Lumix G100, I'll set up a frame rate of 25 frames per second and a sensor size of 13.76mm. And then, let's head straight into the trackers room. There are two ways we can create trackers in the tracker room. The first one is pretty obvious. Choose the magic wand and click anywhere in the image to create a tracker. There's nothing wrong with that, but it has got one caveat. With the magic wand, I can very easily forget that it is still turned on and create accidental trackers. So I will resort to another method that involves a keyboard shortcut. Just press and hold the C button on your keyboard and left click with your mouse. Boom, there's your tracker. The beauty in this is that it only works when you press the hotkey, so you will only create trackers when you actually intend to do so. In general, shortcuts will play a big role when doing supervised tracking. So we created our first tracker. Now what? Well, the easiest and fastest way to run that tracker is to just hit play. Whoa, that was fast. I certainly couldn't see what was going on there or if my tracker held up. So let's kill this tracker by hitting the red cross up here and start tracking once more, with two changes. First, we are going to lock the view to the tracker. By pressing 5 on our keyboard or pressing the follow to D button here, SynthEyes will now lock the view to that selected tracker. I will then zoom in using my mouse wheel. And instead of hitting play, I will step through this frame by frame. I could be using the little playback controls up here, but instead I will be using the hotkeys S for backwards and D for forwards. This takes more time than just blazing through the clip, but also it'll make correcting any errors in the track much easier. It is called supervised tracking after all. And yes, you can hold down D or S for moderate frame-by-frame playback. Now you might be familiar with classical point trackers. The trackers here are literally the same thing. So we've got this target area. With this area, you want to set it up in a distinct contrasty area and choose a pattern that SynthEyes will recognize inside the larger second area, the search area. Now this one should be large enough so that SynthEyes will pick up the target area when moving from frame to frame, but not so large that it would find false positives. To give you an example, if I would crank up the search area to this size, then the SynthEyes might accidentally pick up the pillar to the left or to the right as a pattern as well. For starters, let's go with the default size and just see what happens. We do get some noticeable drifting over time, so that is not ideal. Why is that? SynthEyes will always look for the very first frame where we created our tracker as a reference. But with all moving images, things change over time. So maybe we should just update our reference as we move along. Let's slowly shuttle through this and see where we can tell SynthEyes to pick up a new reference. The first 12 frames look really good, but after that our reference skips upwards for a moment. So on frame 12, we can set a new reference by pressing the null button here or by pressing 0 on the number pad. Take a look at our time bar. A little triangle appeared where our cursor is parked now, and that indicates a new reference keyframe for this tracker. Stepping through this now, I can see the jump is not happening anymore, because now SynthEyes is comparing to the reference from frame 12, not frame 1. Then, around frame 20, our tracker drifts upwards, but lands back safely on its proper place on frame 25. So let me put down a reference here on frame 25 as well, Next, let's go back by hitting S and find the point in time where the drift is the strongest, around frame 20, I would say. There are two ways we can nudge this tracker into place. We can go up here into the tracker viewer and press and hold the left mouse button and tuck it in, or we can use the nudge hotkeys on the number keypad, which are 2 for down, 4 for left, 6 for right, and 8 for up. Either way, the moment we do either of these actions, another keyframe is dropped on our time bar. And you will have noticed another thing. When I moved backwards on the time bar by hitting S, my tracker did not update. The direction of tracking is decided by this arrow button here. So you can move in both directions, but whether you play back or step through frame by frame, the tracker will only update when you are moving in the direction indicated by this button. But if we hit S once more, we still see a jump up. Now I don't want to go through each frame and manually adjust or nudge the position. Instead, we can let SynthEyes do some of that work for us by dialing up the smooth value. This smooth value defines the number of frames before a keyframe it should interpolate between the track position and the position specified by the next keyframe. I will continue tracking this tracker by using D and nudging the tracker in from time to time. At around frame 190, we see the edge of the frame closing in on our tracker, or the other way around. But it seems like this particular tracker has done its job. Like in the previous class, we need to close the padlock up here in order for the tracker to be considered for the solve. Let's unlock our viewer by hitting 5, and then zoom out our view by hitting 8. Now we can look for our next feature to track. Let's scroll back a few frames and select the white spot on the floor. C-click on that spot and there is our new tracker. Before we start tracking away, I want to adjust two settings. First, I want to change direction. So to track backwards, hit the arrow below the tracker viewer or press Shift-R on your keyboard. And now I want to change the tracker mode from RGB to white feature by selecting the white dot on a blue circle. SynthEyes will now have a better lock on the white spot because it really knows what to look for. You'll also get a representation of that white spot in the tracker viewer with the additional crosshair. With this tracking mode, it really helps to narrow down the target area just around the actual dot. To adjust the size, use the little handle in the bottom right of your target area. If you want to move the entire tracker around, pick up the top left corner of the target area. When you're done, don't forget to lock your viewer by pressing 5 again. Take a look how well that tracker locks in there. As we are tracking backwards and thus the feature is getting smaller as we move along, we might adjust the target area size around here. And I want to draw your attention to this one more time. Every time you do a change to the tracker, nudging, scaling, etc., you are automatically putting down another reference keyframe. Next up, we are going to track the three black dots on the rails here. And you might have guessed it. If we change the tracking mode to the black dot on the white circle, these three guys are going to hold on pretty well, as we are now tracking a black spot. Before we continue, let's change our view a bit. I want us to view the camera and graphs. If we want to, we can get into all the nitty-gritty details of our trackers here. But what interests me the most is the background color. Notice that at the beginning of the shot it is yellow, while the latter part is red. Why is that? SynthEyes is telling us if we've already got enough trackers to go for a solve with this color. Red is definitely not enough. You don't even need to try. Yellow might just work, and green means you definitely have got enough trackers. So let's continue tracking features until we are in the green. Having this little traffic light-like control in here is really helpful, but it does take up quite some real estate. We don't need all the graphs to see just these colors. So let's go back to just our camera view and then, on the time bar, right-click and choose Background as Tracker Count. And voila, there are our tracker count colors conveniently displayed right in our time bar. The next feature I want to track is the tip of the arrow here. So for this, I'm going to go with the traditional RGB tracking. but I am going to be even more specific and choose the blue channel to track the tip of the arrow. This will give me more contrast between the arrow and the green sign. I can even see that in the tracker viewer. From there, I'm just going forward by hitting D. Around frame 54, we are about to lose the tracker, so let's lock it up. But if we scroll through our clip, we see the tip of the arrow coming back in at around frame 166. So let's create a new tracker and track from there until the end of the clip. There's just one problem. Now we've got two trackers in exactly the same place. We might get lucky with SynthEyes realizing that, but it is something that could throw off our solve. So to prevent that, let's combine both trackers into a single one. Call up the camera and hierarchy view. Now we can see all the glorious 9 trackers we have created so far. Shuttle through your clip and verify the names of the 2 trackers we want to combine. Number 8 is the one in the beginning, number 9 is the one towards the end. Shift select both trackers and then get up to the trackers menu and select combine trackers. Or use the Shift 7 keyboard shortcut. The new combined tracker will inherit the name of the last tracker selected and the other one will just disappear. So let's continue on. When placing these trackers, you want to make sure to get as much perspective difference as possible. That being said, you'll notice that I haven't set any trackers in the far background. Usually these don't contribute much to the solve, and if I take the time for supervised tracking, then I want to get the most bang for my buck. By staying on the platform and distributing the trackers among it, I get the best possible tracking data with as few trackers as possible. And while we have the hierarchy view open, check these little padlocks. If you've forgotten to lock any of these trackers, you will see it here and can fix it before we attempt our first solve. We have done this for quite a while now, and you might have noticed the search area sometimes jumping around quite a lot. If it still finds the pattern it should look for, that is all good. But if things go awry, you can give SynthEyes a little push by hinting at what kind of camera move to expect. Up until now, we've been using steady camera, which means it expects a not too crazy camera movement. With sticky, SynthEyes will solely refer to the search area. So if you want to use this, make sure your search area is large enough. But as we already created a number of good trackers, SynthEyes can refer to those as well to predict the movement. To use that, we can select handheld, use others. It will of course also look at the search area, but it just adds another layer that can help SynthEyes with finding the pattern. Let's turn our attention to our time bar. It is filling up with green very nicely, but what is happening at the beginning? Why is our time bar turning gray? Don't worry, this is a good sign. It means that we've got enough trackers in this area so that we can even get rid of some during refinement. As we are almost there, let's go the whole 9 yards and aim for a gray time bar, shall we? As we are almost closing in on the finish line, I want to mention a few more things. Unlike with traditional point tracking, a tracker does not need to hold up for the entirety of the shot. Take a look at this one. He holds up for the most part, but as I'm tracking backwards, the detail is lost towards the beginning of the shot and he starts to jitter. But a quick look at my time bar tells me that I've got more than enough trackers in this area. So instead of trying to make it work and probably contributing bad data, I'll just use the traffic light to close this one out. Not immediately when it enters the gray area, but rather when I feel it doesn't contribute any really good data anymore. Another method you can use if you're absolutely sure that you will not want any of that tracking data in there from a certain point in time is deleting forwards and backwards. So take a look at this guy. I'm tracking that one backwards and the further I go, the more jagged my track becomes. So I'll just shuttle to the moment my tracker starts jitterbugging around. Now I shift right click on the now button and SynthEyes will delete all the tracking data in the direction of tracking defined by our arrow here. Another method you might have tried is this little hammer, the finalize tracker button. But honestly, I would be very careful with this. It'll give you the option to smooth out your tracker, but it can be destructive. On a shot like this, I would much rather resort to tracking other features rather than introducing filtered data into my solve. And we have done it. Our time bar is completely gray, which means we have more than enough trackers to attempt the solve. You already know most of this from the previous classes, but repetition is the key to mastery. So let's switch over to the solver room and tell SynthEyes to calculate the lens distortion. We get an error slightly above 1, Not too bad, but not perfect either. Switch on the tracker radar so that we can see what is going on. At first glance, it looks like our tracker on the tip of the arrow is not on point, but actually, the solve is not correct in this place. See how the rectangle is where it is supposed to be, but the crosshair that symbolizes the solved 3D point is just off? So let's see if we can remedy that. As we can be really confident in that tracker, let's just tell SynthEyes to consider it a bit more. We can do that in the tracker's room by opening up the padlock and increasing its weight. Let's double it so SynthEyes will consider it more when refining the solve. Also, let's use the cleanup trackers dialog from last class and just delete or curtail trackers when they get too far off course. And don't panic if our time bar gets greener once again. This is just us using the spare trackers we created in the first place. With green, we can still easily solve or refine. Now the last thing I want us to do for this scene is to once again set up a coordinate system. Once again, I'm going to use the *3 method as a base. These trackers are not ideally placed to define origin, left, right, and plane, but good enough to give me a starting point. From there, I go over to the 3D room and select Hole to move my scene around. I'm mainly using rotation, but also a bit of translation to nudge everything into place. Supervised tracking will help you on a lot of the more challenging shots, as you've got great control over what data is actually supplied to the solver. With the different pattern recognition modes and the ability to select individual channels, you can set up each tracker for its unique task. And with combining trackers, you've got great control over what feature leaves and enters the scene. So I wish you happy tracking, and I will see you in the next class.